Since I'm out filming on location, I might as well share some places with you. This is one of the views I frequently get while out running. That's Blue Mound out there in the background. If you happen to see this view, you're close enough to stop by and say hi. Turning to the task at hand, this video is going to demonstrate how to perform some basic measurements using the oscilloscope. To demonstrate the functionality of the oscilloscope, I'm going to connect the oscilloscope to the function generator through a resistive capacitive circuit. This will allow us to see most of the functionality we need to understand the oscilloscope. To do this, I'm going to use BNC to microclip connectors. These connectors have one end, which is a BNC connector, and another end, which are microclips, hence the name. This allows us to connect into circuits wherever we want. When connecting BNC to microclip connectors, it is very important that all of the black leads from the microclips are connected to the same node on the circuit. This is because the black microclips are connected to earth ground. Since earth ground is our absolute reference for electrical signals, wherever I connect one of the black probes, that point will be grounded or at 0 volts regardless of whatever waveform should be present. I'm using a 1 kilo-ohm resistor and a 1 nanofarad capacitor in series for this demonstration. I'll first connect the output of the function generator across the series combination. This will serve as an input for the circuit. I'll then connect channel 1 of the oscilloscope to the same points. This will give us a picture of our input on the oscilloscope. Finally, I'll connect channel 2 of the oscilloscope across the capacitor so that we can observe the changes the circuit makes to our signal. I'll begin by adjusting the function generator to output a 10 kHz, 1 volt peak-to-peak signal. This produces a display on the oscilloscope which basically tells us nothing. From all we know about the signal, however, we can adjust the oscilloscope so that we can see the waveforms. A 10 kHz sine wave has a period of 100 microseconds. So for us to see the waveforms on the oscilloscope, we will have to adjust the seconds per division so that the full screen displays slightly more than 100 microseconds for us to see at least one full waveform. We can also adjust the volts per division to allow the display to show a 1 volt peak-to-peak signal, which, if you watch the function generator video, you know will actually show up on the oscilloscope as a 2 volt peak-to-peak signal, and that has to do with the output resistance of the function generator. So now the display of the oscilloscope is set up so that the voltage display on both channels 1 and 2 is set to 500 millivolts per division, and the time is set to 25 microseconds per division, and we can see at least 2 full cycles of our waveforms. I can adjust where these waveforms are relative to each other using the position knob for channels 1 and 2. If I press the channel 1 menu button, the right-hand side of the screen changes. The top menu item is called coupling. The options for coupling are DC, AC, and ground. Most often when we are looking at circuits on a breadboard, we want this to be set to DC. AC coupling filters out any DC component there may be with the signal, and ground obviously makes that input zero. Below the coupling, there's something called BW limit. BW stands for bandwidth. This button has 2 options: on or off. If the bandwidth limiting is on, high frequency signals are filtered out. The volts per division menu item allows us to make fine adjustments to the volts per division for the channel. Most of the time we will not touch this. The probe menu item allows us to adjust for different types of probes that we can use with an oscilloscope. With BNC to microclip connectors, the 1X option is correct. There are more advanced probes that we can use with the oscilloscope that will require settings of 10x, 100x, or 1000x. The last button is the invert button, which will allow us to invert a waveform if we desire. The channel 2 button brings up the same exact options for channel 2. In between the channel 1 and channel 2 buttons, there is a math button. The math button will allow us to do some mathematical operations on our signals. For example, we could subtract or add the waveforms from channel 1 and 2 together. One of the reasons we may want to do this is, since the ground probes are absolute ground, if we want to know the voltage difference between 2 points in our circuit that are not connected to ground, subtracting the signals may be our only option. Another math option we have is the FFT or fast Fourier transform. The fast Fourier transform of the signal allows us to see what frequency components are present in the waveform. In this case, since we're looking at a sine wave output from the function generator, we see one peak on the left-hand side of the display and a bunch of noise to the right. This is because the waveform is almost a pure sine wave. Now I will press the measure button. The measure button changes the right hand of the display to show a variety of measurements that the oscilloscope can perform. The top menu button allows us to select source or type. Source allows us to select which channel the measurement is taken from. And if the source is selected, and if I press any of the buttons next to the menu items, we see the channel changes from 1 to 2. If I press the top button so that type is selected, then we can change through the different types of measurements the oscilloscope can perform. I will cycle through these measurements for channel 1. The oscilloscope can display the peak-to-peak value of the waveform, the RMS value of the waveform, the rise time, the fall time, the positive width, which is the width that the signal is high, the negative width, which is the width that the signal is low, to no measurement, to the frequency, the period, the mean value, or back to the peak-to-peak value of the waveform. For any of the measure functions to work, at least one entire waveform must be present on the screen. If I adjust the volts per division so that the top of the waveforms is off the screen, a question mark appears on the peak-to-peak voltage. This means the oscilloscope does not know what the peak-to-peak value is. Likewise, if a full waveform is not displayed on the screen, the frequency measurements will come up as uncertain. The button below the measure button is the cursor button. The cursor button allows us to manually make measurements we want to make. There are two types of cursors we can use: voltage cursors and time cursors. When time cursors are selected, we see two vertical lines are present on the screen of the oscilloscope. The position of those time cursors is controlled by the position knobs on the vertical display, so I can move the cursors anywhere I want on the horizontal axis. I can, for example, position the cursors on two subsequent peaks of a signal waveform. And in the delta section of the display, the difference between those two time cursors are shown along with the frequency that corresponds to that period. If I adjust the input frequency to 100 kilohertz, another purpose of the time cursors can be demonstrated. That would be to determine the phase shift between two waveforms. This is why I chose a resistive capacitive circuit for demonstration purposes. When the sine wave is input to a resistive capacitive circuit, the waveform across the capacitor is shifted in time relative to the input. I can use the cursor function to measure how big of a time shift has occurred. If I position the two waveforms to have the same zero crossing, I can put one of the cursors on the input wave and the other cursor on the zero crossing of the output wave. And we see the shift in time of nearly 1 microsecond. From this information, if I wanted to, I could calculate something called the phase shift between these two waveforms. That may or may not have meaning to you right now, but as you go through your introductory circuits courses, it will have meaning to you. I could also switch the cursors to voltage cursors. This might allow me to see how much of a voltage change there is between two waveforms in very precise terms. One advantage that the cursor measurements have over using the oscilloscope is that the cursor measure functions do not need to have a full waveform displayed on the screen. So if I wanted to zoom in on the waveforms to see a very precise measurement using the cursor functions, I can do that. Let's go over the basics of the trigger menu. On the right-hand side of the oscilloscope, there is a section regarding the trigger. The top knob refers to the trigger level, and as I turn the knob, there is an arrow that goes up and down on the right-hand side of the screen, and that tells the oscilloscope at what voltage level to grab the waveform. If I adjust the trigger level above the actual waveform, the oscilloscope cannot grab onto the wave, and the display becomes unstable. To grab one of the waves again, I simply need to adjust the trigger level into the middle of the wave. The trigger menu button brings up several options for the trigger. I will not go through them all, but let's take a look at the coupling. Sometimes when you are trying to look at a signal, there will be a lot of noise present, and it will be difficult to obtain a stable waveform. By adjusting the coupling on the trigger, very often this can be corrected. The options we have for coupling are DC coupling, noise reject. This will provide a general filter for noise in a signal. High frequency reject will get rid of the high frequency components of the wave. Low frequency reject will get rid of low frequency noise, such as the 60 Hz signal that we often pick up from the electricity in the room. AC coupling will block out any DC portions of the signal, and then we are back to DC coupling. If we are having trouble triggering a signal, very often just cycling through these options will correct our problem. If we are using a function generator to generate our signal, and we are having a lot of trouble getting our signals to trigger, we can use the sync output from the function generator with the external trigger option on the oscilloscope. For that, I will use a BNC cable to connect the sync to the external trigger. To use the external trigger, I go to the button next to trigger, source, on the oscilloscope screen, and select external. This allows the oscilloscope to trigger off of the very stable square wave, the sync of the function generator outputs, and renders any distortion of the output of the function generator irrelevant.
Now you should be able to, at least, muddle through a few measurements using the oscilloscope. Like anything, it will take some time and practice to feel comfortable and proficient in the use of the scope. You may already be able to imagine that once you do, it will be a great asset to your laboratory analysis toolbox. That's all for today. Go out and make it a great one.